A very good morning to all my dear students. Welcome back to your science class. In our previous class, we started chapter number 12, Reproduction in Plants. From that chapter, we studied some topics like introduction, vegetative propagation, which comes under asexual reproduction, which is one of the mode of reproduction in plants. Today, we will study the rest of the asexual modes of reproduction in plants, which are budding, fragmentation, and spore formation. Other than this, we will study sexual reproduction as well. After that, we will cover fruit and seed formation, and the last topic, which is seed dispersal. So let's start with our first topic, budding. What is budding? First of all, we should know what is a bud. When a small bulb-like projection comes out from any cell, that part is called bud. Here in this picture, you can see a small bulb-like projection coming out from the yeast cell, which is also called as bud. Budding is a type of asexual reproduction in which a new organism develops from an outgrowth or bud due to cell division at one particular site. Since the reproduction is asexual, the newly created organism is a clone, which is genetically identical to the parent organism. To understand budding, let's see an activity. This is activity number 12.3. For this activity, you need a small amount of yeast powder. Take a small amount of yeast in a container and add water in it. You may add a spoonful of sugar and shake to dissolve it. Keep it in a warm part of a room, and then after an hour, put a drop of this liquid on a glass slide and observe under the microscope. What will you observe? You may see the formation of new yeast cells. The small bulb-like projections, which are called as bud, gradually grows and gets detached from the parent cell and forms a new yeast cell. The new yeast cell grows, matures, and produces more yeast cells. If this process continues, a large number of yeast cells are produced in a short time, as you can see in this picture. Our second topic is fragmentation. Some organisms have the ability to break into two or more fragments, with the new fragment becoming a new independent individual. They multiply rapidly in a short period of time. That is why fragmentation is also known as a splitting method of reproduction and is seen in many organisms such as cyanobacteria, fungi, and many other plants. You might have seen some slimy green patches in ponds. These are algae. When water and nutrients are available, algae grow and multiply rapidly by fragmentation. An alga breaks up into two or more fragments. These fragments or pieces grow into new individuals. This process continues and they cover a large area in a short period of time. Fragmentation is a very common type of vegetative reproduction in plant. It occurs when a shoot that is rooted becomes detached from the main group. Then comes spore formation. Spores are present in the air and are covered by a hard protective coat to bear low humidity and high temperature conditions. Spores germinate and develop into new organisms under favorable conditions. You may observe spores in a cotton-like mesh on the bread. When spores are released, they keep floating in the air as they are very light and can cover long distances. Under favorable conditions, a spore germinates and develops into a new individual, and plants such as moss and ferns also reproduce by means of spores. Now we have covered all the topics under asexual reproduction, which were vegetative propagation, budding, fragmentation, and spore formation. Now we'll start sexual reproduction. Reproductive parts of plants are flowers. In our previous video, we studied about the structure of flower and their reproductive parts. Stamen being male reproductive part and pistil being the female reproductive part. If one of these reproductive parts are present in a flower, it is said to be a unisexual flower. For example, papaya. If both stamen and pistil are present in flowers, they are called as bisexual flowers. Example, rose. Both male and female unisexual flowers may be present in the same plant or in different plants. The male reproductive part, stamen, consists of anther and filament. Anther contains pollen grains which produces male gametes. And the pistil consists of style, stigma and ovary. The ovary consists of one or more ovules. Ovules are where female gametes or the egg is formed. Female and male gametes fuse to form a zygote. Now we have to study pollination, which comes under sexual reproduction. Then we will study fertilization. When pollen is transferred from the anther to the stigma of a flower through carriers such as wind, water, or even by insects, then this process is called as pollination. It can be a case of self-pollination if pollen lands on the stigma of the same flower or another flower of the same plant. But if pollen grains land on stigma of a flower of a different plant but of the same kind, it is called as cross-pollination. Now let's study fertilization. Male and female gametes fuse to form a zygote. A zygote is formed as a result of the fusion of gametes, which later develops into the embryo. Fruits and seeds are formed post-fertilization. Ripened ovary goes on to become a fruit. Ovules give rise to seeds which contain the embryo in the protective covering. And now we have covered sexual reproduction as well. Let's study fruits and seed formation. As you can see in this picture, an adult plant produces a flower. Pollination and fertilization takes place. After that, each ovule within the flower's ovary contains a fertilized egg, which keeps on growing and making the fruit as the ripened ovary. Petals and stamens fall away. Then each ovule becomes a seed and ovary becomes the fruit. When the fruit ripens, the seed are dispersed. Each seed contains a tiny plant. If a seed sprouts or begins to grow, it will become a new plant. Some fruits are fleshy and juicy, such as mango, apple, and orange, and some are hard like almond and walnuts. Now let's study our last topic, which is seed dispersal. Plants make seeds that grow into a new plant. But if seeds just fall off to the ground under the parent plant, they might not get enough sun, water, or nutrients from the soil. Because plants cannot walk around and take their seeds to other places, they have developed other methods to disperse or move their seeds. The most common methods are wind, water, animal, and explosion, and also fire. Plants benefit by seed dispersal. It prevents the competition between the plant and its own seedlings for sunlight, water, and minerals. It enables plants to invade new habitats for wider distribution. Have you ever blown on a dandelion head and watched the seeds float away? This is when dispersal. Some plants like kauri and maple trees have winged seeds. They don't float away but flutter to the ground. With wind dispersal, the seeds are simply blown about and land in all kinds of places. To help their chances that at least some of the seeds land in a place suitable for growth, these plants have to produce lots of seeds. Here in this image, you can see winged seeds such as those of drumstick and maple, and light seeds of grasses and hairy fruit of sunflower get blown off with the wind to far away places. Many plants have seeds that use water as the means of dispersal. The seeds float away from the parent plant. They usually develop floating ability in the form of spongy or fibrous outer coat, as in coconut. Kauri trees also use water dispersal. They have a hard seed coat that allows them to float down streams and rivers. That is one of the reasons kauri trees are commonly found on the stream banks. Some seeds are dispersed by animals, especially spiny seeds with hooks which get attached to the bodies of animals and are carried to distant places, like xanthium and urena. Humans can also spread seeds if they get stuck to our clothing or shoes. Some seeds are dispersed when the fruits burst with sudden jerks. The seeds are scattered far from the parent plant. This happens in case of castor and balsam. Some plants like peas, flax have seed pods. Some plants like peas and flax have seed pods that dry out once the seeds are ripe. When dry, the pods split open and the seeds scatter. Plants cannot run away from a fire, so some plants have developed a way to help their seeds survive. There are some species of pine trees that require the heat from a fire before their cones will open and release seeds. For this, the intensity and the timing of fire is important. It needs to be hot enough to trigger the cones to open. But if fires are too frequent, there is not enough time for the plants to grow big enough to make new seeds. That is all about reproduction in plants. Hope you have understood the topics which we have studied today. Keep studying. Take care. See you in our next class.